In this video from ITFreeTraining, I will look at naming conventions. In small networks, you can get by without a naming convention. However, on large networks, or if your network expands, it is important to have a good naming convention in place, as it is difficult to change later on. In the old days of computing, we're talking about the 90s, which is a long time ago in computing, I used a Unix server called Wumpus. What is a Wumpus? It's a rare, strong creature that likes to eat people and hang from ceilings. Does the name Wumpus tell us anything about what the server does or where the server is? The answer is no. In small networks, you could name all your computers after Simpson characters or movie characters if you wish. But this does not give any indication what the computer does or is not looked on as professional in the IT industry. Many companies in the early days have regretted later on using a naming convention like these, and nowadays would not even consider it. In this video, I will look at ways to name your printers, computers, servers, email addresses, and file shares, but first, I will look at what makes a good naming convention. There are many different naming conventions in use today, and if you have the chance to work in different companies, it is more than likely each company is using a different naming convention. The choice of naming conventions comes down to what an individual administrator feels is important and what they are trying to achieve. A useful naming convention provides useful information like location, owner, and usage type. When you start to consider a naming convention, start to think about your current and future needs. If all your computers are in the one country, and this is unlikely to change, it is probably not necessary to include the country in the naming convention. The administrator needs to consider factors like these to get the best out of the naming convention they choose. When possible, the naming convention should be inventory friendly. If your naming convention works with your audit software, it will make your job a lot easier. Lastly, your naming convention should have a low chance of collisions. This occurs mainly with email addresses. If, for example, you were to use only the first name of the person in an email address, then there is a high chance that in the long term, the company will hire a second person with the same first name. When collisions like these occur, the second username tends to be something different. Usually adding a number to the end fixes this, but you will want to avoid this whenever possible. First, I will look at printers. One of the big mistakes I have seen in my career, in my opinion, is to include model names in the printer name. Consider that your company buys a basic printer. It is made by the company Dart, so it is given the name Dart 01. The problem occurs when the printer is replaced. There is a good chance the printer will be replaced by a printer manufactured by a different company. The new printer is made by Whiz Printers. The problem occurs when, in order to get the printer going as quick as possible, the old printer name of Dart 01 is used. Changing the printer name would mean reinstalling the printer on every user's computer that is using that printer. If the printer was to fail suddenly and had to be replaced, the quickest way for the administrator to get the printer working again would be to use the old name. I have seen scenarios like these in the workplace where a printer is replaced and the old printer name is used for years later. The administrator could also name the printer after characteristics of the printer, for example, if the printer was color or not. In this example, the printer has been replaced by a printer that does double-sided printing, collating, stapling, and A3 printing. If the printer name Color 01 was still used, this does not describe any of the new features that printer has. I will now look at two different naming standards for printers. There are endless amounts of ways an administrator could choose to name their printers, and it is a matter of choosing the best one for your company. In this example, we have a printer in the United States, in the state of New York, on level 1 of a large office building in the art department. The printer is also the third printer to be installed in the art department. In this example, the printer would be called USA NY LVL1 Art 03. You can see this printer name is quite long, however, quite descriptive. From the name alone, you get a good idea of where the printer is located in the world. This naming standard is good for very large organizations. This would be a good system to use for companies like Microsoft, who have over 100,000 employees and offices all over the world. The second standard I will look at is a simple version of the first, more suited for smaller organizations. This could be used when you have a small number of printers, but they are spread out over a large area. In this example, you will find the closest airport and use the international airport code for that airport, and then combine it with the number of the printer. In this case, it would give you SYD03. You could also use country codes depending on your needs. This may seem very simple, but if you consider that most organizations now are using a small number of photocopiers rather than a large number of printers, you may find that your company has a surprising few number of printers compared to 10 or 20 years ago. It is a matter of the administrator looking at their needs and considering what their future needs will be. The next point to consider is how you are going to name the computers on your network. One example is to start with the division. Companies are divided up into different areas, but generally come under one large division that will generally be where the money comes from for the computers. Next, consider the location of the computer. In this case, the closest airport was used, but you may want to use country or state. Next, the type of computer was used. In this case, desktop. I have not included it here, but you could also include operating system. Lastly, I have used the asset tag. Some companies will put an asset tag on their computers to help identify them. You could also use the serial number, but it is best to keep the computer name to 15 characters or less for compatibility reasons. Once all these items are combined, they give ITSID D00001. You can see this computer name is quite descriptive. If an administrator was to see this computer name in a log file, this would give them a lot of information about the computer that generated the event in the log file. The next naming standard that I will look at is server names. Generally, a server is named after the location and its task. In this example, the server would be called NYFS01, since it is located in New York and is a file server. If more file servers were added to the network, they could simply have the number on the end incremented. In most cases, there are a lot less servers than desktops and laptops, so there is generally no need to include the asset tag in the server name. Even if you have a large server room with hundreds of servers, the servers are all in one location and easy to audit if required, so there's no need to have the asset tag in the server name. However, it is up to the administrator how they want to do this. Including details like the OS in the server name is generally not done. This is because the OS on the server may be upgraded or the server could be replaced. It is not uncommon for end users to be connecting to a particular server, and over the years, the server OS is upgraded and the hardware replaced, but the name of the server stays the same. The next standard I will look at is for email addresses. Like before, there are many different standards in use. The point to remember is that collisions decrease as length and complexity increase. To understand what a collision is, consider this example. In this network, there are four users. To start with, I will look at using a naming standard that just uses their first name. In this case, you can see that there are two users with the first name of John. This is called a collision, when two or more usernames result in the same email address. When this occurs, most companies will add a number to the end of one of the email addresses to make them unique. You, of course, want to create a naming system that reduces the number of collisions. To test how good this naming standard is, I used a random name generator to generate 1,000 names. I then ran a number of naming standards on that list. 17% of the people in the list had the same name as another person in the organization. You can see that even though this standard creates very short email addresses, in a reasonably sized organization, you will start having a lot of collisions. The next standard I will look at is first name followed by last name. When I ran this standard with the 1,000 random generated names, I got 2% collisions. The next standard I ran was first name followed by last initial. This resulted in 4% collisions. This tends to suggest that last names are more unique than first names. The last standard I ran was first name followed by last name separated by a period. This is a common standard I see used in a lot of organizations. This resulted in zero collisions. With a larger group of names, it is likely to get some collisions, but this will be rare. I have seen companies use middle initials in the email address as well. Even though this does reduce the number of possible collisions even more, I personally think it is not necessary unless the organization is very large, for example, over 10,000 employees. There is also the problem you may encounter where a staff member does not have a middle name. This does make things more complicated, especially when attempting to do data linking between different systems. I have seen one company administrator use an X for staff without a middle name, where another administrator left the initial out completely. This made writing code to link different systems together quite interesting. To avoid the headache, I would not use the middle name and not use X for staff without a middle name, but that is just my opinion. To finish, I will look at how to name file shares in your organization. In the old days of Windows, if you wanted to hide a share so it could not be browsed, you would end the share with a dollar sign. This tended to be used when you had hundreds of user shares on one server. Users only require access to their own share and do not need to look at the other shares. Nowadays, hiding a share can be achieved in a number of different ways. For example, using access based on enumeration will hide folders the user does not have access to, creating the same effect. An administrator could also just configure the share to be hidden, something that in the older versions of Windows was not possible. If you are creating home shares, then the same kind of naming standard can be used that was used for email addresses. In a lot of cases, the chance of collisions is lower since staff are spread out between different servers. For example, a company with thousands of staff around the world would be unlikely to have two staff with the same name working at the same office connecting to the same file server. So the administrator may go for a simpler naming standard than that used for email addresses. With other shares, there are no real rules, but generally something short and descriptive works well. For example, a public accessible share could just be called public. For a department share, you could start with DEP followed by a short name for the department. The choice is really up to the administrator to decide what works for them. If you are planning to implement your own naming system in the real world, how would you go about it? First, consider your current and future needs. If it looks like the company will expand overseas, it may be worth putting a country code in the naming convention. If all your computers are in the same country and this does not look like it is going to change, there is no point in putting a country code in the computer name. Consider how often the names will change. New computers move around a lot or get upgraded. If computers are moved around, it may not be worth putting the department name in a computer name. The same goes for the operating system, if the computer is likely to be upgraded. If changes like these occur and you have the location or the OS in the computer name will no longer describe the computer. This makes supporting these computers more confusing for the support people unless the computer names are changed as well, which is more work for the administrators and support staff. Next, you should consider what information is collected by management software. The software that you manage the computers on may collect a lot of the information that you are planning to put into the computer name. If it is doing a good job of managing this, there may not be any point adding that info to the name. You should consider if you can use group policy and Active Directory to achieve the same results. Printers that are near the user can automatically be installed using group policy. It is just a matter of dividing them up into different containers in Active Directory and applying group policy. In Active Directory, additional fields about where the printer is and what features the printer has can be recorded. If this is the case, a simple printer name can be used. Computer names should be kept to 15 characters or less. DNS supports larger computer names, however, these may cause compatibility problems with systems like Windows file sharing. Do not use special characters in the names. Even if they are allowed in the device name, these can cause problems later on with inventory software. Start computer names and printer names with a letter. If you start them with a number, even if it is allowed, this can cause problems with auditing software. Names that are all digits will be interpreted as numbers by certain software. This can cause problems linking the data between different programs. If you are planning on using asset tags with barcodes, for the same reasons as stated before, make sure you start the barcode with a letter. Otherwise, when you scan the barcode, some software may interpret this as a number. This will cause linking problems when you have one software interpreting it as alphanumeric and another software interpreting it as numeric. Thanks for watching this video from IT Free Training. I hope you found it useful. I hope to see you in our other videos in this course and others. Until then, thanks for watching.